is another blessed day when we get to share knowledge, ideas, and blessings through Adventist World Radio, the voice of hope. This is New Life Program brought to you by Chileno Diam. I'm glad that you have joined me on yet another edition of New Life Program. Today, we are going to find out on how different families experience problems because of the way they communicate with each other. Susan Apondi will be telling us more about this in the Family Life segment. Without forgetting, Pastor Kigundu Ndwiga, who will also be sharing with us on a topic, The Master, will return during the Bible segment. Stay tuned for this and much wonderful items coming your way.
Come the fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me ever to adore thee, may I still thy goodness prove. While the hope of endless glory fills my heart with joy and danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be.
Let thy goodness like a fetter bind me closer still to thee.
Seal it for thy courts above.
Most couples normally have problems, especially when it comes to communication. When there is lack of proper communication in a relationship, there's likely a high possibility of the couples not staying together for a long time. Let us listen to what Susan Apondi has to say concerning communication problems in relationships. Be enlightened.
In our family program today, we shall talk about communication problems in a relationship. Is your relationship in a mess? This may be because of lack of communication. Also, it may be because we do not give our partners time to express themselves. It can also be due to the mixing of money in our relationship. As partners or couples, you experience problems in your relationships due to lack of communication. But today, we will try to solve this problem and tip on how to avoid money communication problems in relationships. Before we start the program, I would like you to invite your partner so that you can both benefit from today's topic. Because of the sensitivity of this topic, it's good that you prepare enough to avoid interruption in between the program. I am Susan Apondi. Intimate relationship offers solace, nurturing, support, happiness, and fun. Sometimes they originate distress, frustration, and deep despair. Stress on most relationships can be placed by the normal times of highs and lows in attraction, energy, and enthusiasm. However, we have limited control over these areas. Many problems come from factors such as job and financial pressures, or aims and desires being different between people. There are some areas in which changes can be made. This can re-energize relationship satisfaction and open the way for renewed growth instead of being locked into communication problems in your relationships. Poor communication creates problems in relationships. The way we talk or don't talk to one another causes lots of distress and tensions. When one partner has a demand or intrusive communication style, the other partner pulls away or will not communicate in return. This leads to poor communication in your relationship. Poor communication is also when you attempt to influence your partner with your negativity, as in anger and sadness. When you personally make accusations to your partner, such as putting him or her down with criticism, such as laziness, instead of explaining that it is a behavior rather than the person that concerned you. Communication breakdown is also as a result of you not showing any concern or emphatic understanding. This is through physical or emotional response to your partner. Get rid of distractions like TV or radio sounds and make a time to talk that is agreeable to both of you. Do not interrupt your partner mid-sentence or talk over them. If you are concerned or feel hurt by the conversation, try to summarize what you have heard to see if what you heard was accurate. Don't label your partner. Keep your attention on his or her actions, not the person. Personalized attacks will not improve the situation. Speaking about specific instances of behaviors gives opportunities for changes to be made. Try to communicate in an encouraging and positive manner, which shows you are supporting rather than putting them down. Always discuss the good aspect about your relationships. Do not focus on the poor communication in the relationship. Common responses for poor problem solving are failing to see the cause of the problem. You may be concluding your partner's recent lack of interest. This means you are losing his or her love for you. In reality, this may be untrue. Poor problem solving is because of having a quick fix solution which misses the mark. You may be thinking that a vacation will be a quick fix solution, rather than seeing that small changes in your daily life may make all the difference. Another problem is trying to fix the problem without your partner. Failing to work out solutions together can bring about blame for each other when things seem to be falling apart. To get out of poor communication in relationships, you need problem-solving skills. They include to factor down bigger problems into smaller ones and then work on each one individually. This slices up those big issues, making them less overwhelming and more manageable. Also, looking at all possibilities in your options and strategies before selecting a solution. Often the least turns out to be the most useful. Keep involving your partners, as both of you need to experience a sense of shared ownership in what you are doing. Don't forget to ask each other for ideas and views and get regular feedback. If you do this, you will get rid of poor communication in your relationships. Always concentrate on the true and keep learning from each experience. Always be aware of what you did and when success is a bit harder. See what adjustment you need to make next time. Lastly, listener, we look at tips to avoid money communication problem in your relationship. When couples decide to take the step of internal commitment, they are ready to embrace each other, outstanding qualities, and accept any less than ideal traits. However, before walking down the aisle, you need to be armed with tactics to handle any communication problems in your relationship. To do this, couples need to discuss how they will be spending their money as husband and wife. Money affects romantic relationships. Too often in relationships, money is an emotionally charged subject that causes sparks to fly. Honest communication can keep your relationship from becoming another statistic caused by unnecessary communication problems. Communicate about your current situation. This includes telling your spouse about any debt or credit problems that you may bring to the relationship. While this may be a hard thing to do, being honest now may prevent communication problems. Discuss financial priorities on how you would like to spend your money in the future. Think about the large and unnecessary costs such as new house and educational savings. Also, it is important to discuss the cost of recurrent leisure activities such as weekend entertainment and hobbies. Such discussions will minimize communication problems in your relationship. Discuss financial goals. Write your individual short-term and long-term financial goals. Then share the goals with your partner and discuss their similarities and differences. Remember that you and your partner are headed in different directions. Neither one of you will get there, and the communication problem in your relationships will be immense. Plan to share financial responsibilities. Both of you must be aware of the overall financial situation. Plan monthly meetings to discuss your financial and app and keep files regarding your investments, account and accessible. Make all significant financial decisions together to avoid necessary communication problems in your relationship. Understand your individual rights and responsibilities. Learn about your individual privileges and liabilities to help minimize communication problems. This could provide future financial security in a time of need. Listener, we are coming to the end of our program. Bear in mind that the most important money move you might make for your relationship is to embrace your differences. Understand that you cannot change the feeling created by a lifetime of experience. Try to cultivate the true aspects of each of your styles. There is no one right to handle your finances. A marriage of your money styles may be perfect solution. Until next time, I am Susan Apondi.
Thank you for staying tuned. In case you're just joining us, this is Adventist World Radio, the voice of hope. I am your host, Chileno Dhiambu. Send us your views, comments, and suggestions about this program by writing to the producer, Adventist World Radio, P.O. Box 42276, code 00100, Nairobi, Kenya. Our email address is awrnairobi@eau.adventist.org.
Sweet little Jesus boy, they made you be born in a manger. Sweet little holy child, didn't come to save us, Lord, to take our sins away. Our eyes was blind, we couldn't see. Down at Yale. and told us how we is a trying master you done showed us how just seem like we can't do right. Look how we treated you. But please, sir, forgive us, Lord. We didn't know 'twas you. Sweet little Jesus boy, long time ago, sweet little holy child, and we didn't know who
hope you have enjoyed that song courtesy of Adventist World Radio, the voice of hope. I'm your presenter, Chileno Diambu. I'm sure many of us are anticipating on the second coming of Jesus Christ. Pastor Kigundu is more than prepared to share with us on a topic known as The Master Will Return. Be blessed.
Dear listener, ready or not, the Master will return. When you read Matthew 25 verse 19, it says, after a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. One fact which many of us do not realize, even though we pay lip service to, is the fact that our master will surely return. The passage of time sometimes lessens the urgency of the coming of our Lord. But as sure as the sun rises from the east, Jesus will come. Verse 19, which we have read, predicts a long delay. The parable of the 10 virgins reveals what actually happens when the bridegroom tarries. The saints all slumber and sleep. The long wait has a way of making us careless and insensible to the demands that the Lord has on each of us. You remember when we were first baptized, many of us loved the Lord and were faithful stewards of His property. Unfortunately, the delay has made us careless. The real truth is that most of us would really be shocked to see Jesus Christ coming now because our accounts are not in order. Many of us have become like the steward in Matthew 24, verse 48 to 50. This is what the Bible says. But suppose that servant is wicked and says to himself, my master is staying away a long time. And he then begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and drink with the drunkards. The master of that servant will come on the day when he does not expect him and at an hour when he is not aware of. So whether we are ready or not, whether we like it or not, our master will come. When he comes, he will settle accounts with each and every one of us. It is then we will find out whether being a faithful steward is paid or not. Jesus makes this very clear in Revelation 22 verse 12, where he says, "Behold, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give to everyone according to what he has done." Beloved, the kind of reward he'll give you will be determined by what you and I have done with what has been entrusted to us. I want us now to look closely at the rewards. The Bible is very clear about the rewards that the stewards are given. The basis of the rewards depends on the kind of stewardship exercised by the steward. There are two kinds of rewards: eternal life or eternal damnation. Talking about that day of reckoning, Prophet Daniel says in Daniel 12 verse 2, "Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt." Jesus adds in John 5 verse 28 and 29, he says, "Do not be amazed at these, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good will rise to live, and those who have done evil will rise to be condemned." It is very clear that if we are unfaithful stewards, even if we are in the graves, we are not beyond our master's reach. He will resurrect us so that we can give an account of our stewardship. From the parable of Jesus, the following can be gleaned. Verse 21 and 23 bring out a very important fact. The rewards for both faithful stewards are the same because the master tells them both, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." So, dear listener, the reward for faithfulness is the same. Therefore, as we utilize our talents and our abilities, we must not be envious of those who receive more. All my master expects of me is to be faithful with what he has given me. All the master expects from me is a faithful tithe of what he has given me and a freewill offering in keeping with his blessing. In verse 24 to 30, Jesus goes to great lengths to show the faith of the unfaithful steward. A close analysis of the action of this steward is not that he squandered the property of the master like most of us do. No, he simply refused to invest. In my opinion, if I gave somebody my money and he returns it intact, I would commend him than if he actually stole from me. Stealing is more serious than not investing. However, the fact that the servant was not faithful in carrying out his master's instructions was in itself enough to bring serious punishment upon him. Our main problem is that, like the steward in this parable, we do not carry out the instructions of our master, but we question the right he has to tell us what to do. From the Bible, the faith of the unfaithful steward is very evident. When you read Matthew 25 verse 30, it says, "And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." The master of the servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at that hour when he is not aware of, he will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. These words, "cutting into pieces," implies to meet death upon the unfaithful steward. In conclusion, from the words of Jesus, it is very clear that God cannot tolerate unfaithfulness on the part of the stewards. It is a biblical fact that unfaithful stewards will be locked out of the New Jerusalem. Those who argue that God cannot leave all those millions of members out of the kingdom just on the basis of faithfulness in stewardship need to remember that in salvation history, God saved only Lot and his daughters because they were faithful to him. God is looking for faithful stewards who are willing to follow the narrow path and pay any cost that following Jesus demands. The challenge comes to you, dear listener. Are you willing to be a faithful steward regardless of the cost? May the Lord give you the grace to follow him all the way and to be particular in following his instructions without wavering. Dear listener, Please do not allow the devil to incorporate you into the greatest delusion, which makes many think they can inherit the kingdom of heaven even if they are unfaithful stewards. Amen and amen.
We have come to the end of today's New Life program. It has been a pleasure having your company. Stay tuned to Adventist World Radio for other great items coming your way. Remember to send us your views, comments, and suggestions regarding this program. Do so by sending them to the producer, Adventist World Radio, P.O. Box 42276, code 00100, Nairobi, Kenya. Our email address is awrnairobi@eau.adventist.org. From me, Tilen Odhiambo, and on behalf of the New Life production team, we wish you a blessed week.
Come the fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me ever to adore thee, may I still thy goodness prove. While the hope of endless glory fills my heart with joy and love, here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be.
Let thy goodness like a fetter bind me closer still to thee.
Seal it for thy courts above.
Only a boy named David, only a little sling.
Only a boy named David, but he could pray and sing.
Only a boy named David, only a little brook.
Only a boy named David, but five little stones he took.
And one little stone went in the sling, and the sling went round and round. And one little stone went in the sling, and the sling went round and round.
And round and round and round and round and
round and round and round.
And one little stone went up in the air,
and the giant came tumbling down.
And the giant came tumbling down.
And the giant came tumbling down. Came tumbling down.
Only a boy named David.
Only a boy named David.
Only a little sling.
Only a little sling.
Only a boy named David.
Only a boy named David.
He could pray and sing.
He could pray and sing.
Only a boy named David.
Only a boy named David at the brook.
Only a boy named David.
But five little stones he took. And one little stone went in the sling, and the sling went round and round. And one little stone went in the sling, and the sling went round and round.